Honorable, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, then we forward to the next agenda is the plenary session one. This plenary session will be facilitated by Dr. Tri Yunis Miko, MSc, as moderator. Pak Nusli Iman Shah from PPSDM, Dr. Alden Henderson from USCDC, Dr. Rim Kwang Il from WHO Indonesia. We invite to the moderator and all speakers to have the floor. Thank you.
Selamat siang sekarang. Jadi sudah hampir jam 12, jam 12 kurang 10. Bapak Ibu sekalian, karena kita harus strict kepada jadwal, harusnya tadi kita mulai jam 10 lewat 25 menit, sekarang sudah jam 12 kurang 10 menit. Jadi waktunya kita akan sedikit kurangi. Oke, ladies and gentlemen, we will start with for the first sessions because we have limited time and we have to stick to the schedule. So now we only have 1 hour for the sessions. So for all the speaker, Dr. Adam, Hakim, dan Pak Nusli, we will have 15 minutes for presentations and 15 minutes for question and answers. Ladies and gentlemen, we have three speakers. First, Pak Nusli from PPSDM will talk on hasil JEE tahun 2017 dan rencana pengembangan FETP dalam memenuhi kebutuhan akan tenaga ahli epidemiologi di lapangan di Indonesia. The second speaker will be Pak Alden Henderson. We'll talk on the role of epidemiology at MOH as National Public Health Institute. And the third speaker will be Dr. Rim Kwang Il from WHO Indonesia. We'll talk on, is it in Indonesia, pentingnya tenaga epidemiologi menjadi bagian dari GORN, or it is the role of epidemiologists in GORN, right? Okay. So the first speaker will be Pak Nusli. Floor is yours now.
Terima kasih. Baik, terima kasih Pak Moderator, yang saya hormati Dr. Alden dan Dr. Kim. Bapak, pertama-tama saya mau menyampaikan permohonan maaf kapus karena beliau tidak bisa hadir pada kesempatan ini dan saya diminta untuk mewakili. Lanjut. Nah, ini latar belakangnya bahwa JEE difokuskan pada SDM di KUS-4 dan kami waktu itu rapat berkali-kali dengan lintas sektor dan ternyata yang terlibat memang bukan hanya orang kesehatan tapi juga termasuk dokter hewan. Latar belakangnya yang lagi bahwa penyediaan kapasitas harusnya berlaku di pusat, provinsi, dan kabupaten kota. Yang sampai saat ini Bapak dan Ibu sekalian banyak katan kapasitas SDM justru diinisiasi oleh pusat. Sedangkan daerah kelihatannya masih nunggu pusat sajalah, terutama dari sektor pembiayaan dan pelatihan. Kemudian pencapaian program pengembangan SDM difokuskan untuk memiliki kompetensi inti sesuai dengan IAHR dan PVC. Lanjut. Nah, ini pengembangan tenaga kesehatan targetnya adalah satu ahli epid lapangan terlatih per 200.000 penduduk. Saya sempat mendiskusikan 200.000 penduduk ini kan berarti sebarannya belum terbaca. Sekarang bagaimana petanya, ini mungkin tugas dari kita untuk melihat bagaimana pemetaannya. Dan pemetaannya nanti juga Bapak Ibu seharusnya mencakup bagaimana tingkat provinsi, kabupaten, dan pelaksana di puskesmas atau UPT-UPT lain. Sekali lagi bahwa tenaga epidnya itu terdiri dari dokter, dokter hewan, dokter kesehatan hewan, tenaga biostatistik dan sebagainya. Jadi ini adalah gabungan dari berbagai disiplin keilmuan baik di bidang kesehatan maupun di kedokteran hewan. Lanjut, mungkin saya akan cepat saja. Nah, indikatornya tersedia sumber daya manusia untuk implementasi persyaratan kapasitas inti IHR dan terdapat program pelatihan EPIT, ini karena kami di pelatihan. Dalam rapat-rapat sebetulnya sudah pernah dilakukan pembahasan tentang pendidikan FITP yaitu di Pusrenggun. Karena waktu yang terbatas kami belum bisa menyajikan datanya. Kemudian strategi ketenaga kerjaannya. Lanjut. Ini indikator pertama. Bapak dan Ibu, ini hasil dari penilaian kami bahwa negara telah memiliki SDM berbagai multidisiplin dan sudah tersebar sampai tingkat kabupaten kota. Hanya sekali lagi sumber data yang kami gunakan ini masih menggunakan data-data yang ada di pemerintahan, baik di Kementerian Kesehatan maupun di Kementerian Pertanian. Nah, di samping itu untuk tenaga field epidemiologi gunakan data-data yang dimiliki oleh organisasi profesi. Kemudian di pemerintahan kita mengenal pejabat fungsional baik di kesehatan kesehatan maksud saya di pertanian, peternakan maupun di Kementerian Kesehatan. Nah, data jabatan fungsional ini ternyata juga masih belum terdata dengan baik. Standar kompetensi pejabat fungsional ini harusnya dievaluasi juga secara berkala, dan ya alhamdulillah mulai tahun kemarin Badan PSDM telah mulai mengevaluasi seluruh pejabat fungsional. Salah satu yang dievaluasi apakah fungsi pejabat fungsional kalau dalam ini epidemiologi, epidemiolog antara provinsi kemudian kabupaten puskesmas harus sama karena di dalam Permenpan itu sama. Dan sekarang kita sudah mulai mengklasterisasi sehingga nanti tugasnya betul-betul terukur. Lanjut. Kemudian standar pendidikan SDM mengacu pada standar ditetapkan Kemenristek Dikti. Artinya Bapak Ibu, begitu kami bicara soal kompetensi dari lulusan, kita mengacu pada Kemenristek Dikti. Kemudian standar pelatihan ini di bawah Kementerian Kesehatan sesuai dengan aturan perundangan yang berlaku saat ini, khususnya di pusat pelatihan SDM Kesehatan. Tetapi dalam prosesnya ini kami tidak bekerja sendiri. Untuk substansi tentunya kami akan melibatkan organisasi profesi dan seterusnya. Pelatihan yang bersifat teknis diberikan secara lintas program dan lintas sektor. Nanti akan saya sampaikan apa yang sudah mulai kami lakukan untuk merancang pelatihan epidemiologi lapangan. Lanjut. Ini saya pikir untuk mempersingkat Bapak Ibu, kita akan beberapa akan saya skip. Sekitar 200 kabupaten kota telah memiliki tenaga epidemi lapangan yang memperkuat kemampuan kabupaten kota. Permasalahannya Bapak Ibu, kabupaten kota itu untuk manajemen SDM-nya di luar kontrol Kementerian Kesehatan. Sehingga pelatihan-pelatihan tenaga epidemiologi itu tidak bisa kita atur penempatannya. Itu sangat tergantung pada daerah. Oleh sebab itu, pendekatan yang paling tepat nanti untuk mengatur supaya mereka tetap di posisinya adalah melalui peraturan. Dan ini sudah dimungkinkan dengan adanya peraturan tentang syarat jabatan dan peta jabatan. Lanjut. Fellowship ini sebagian besar masih disediakan oleh pusat. Kemudian FATP pelatihan juga diikuti oleh para pengajar perguruan tinggi dan staf veteriner dari Kementerian Pertanian. Ini hasil-hasil yang sudah kami kumpulkan pada tahun 2017. Lanjut. Kemudian pelatihan applied epidemiologi juga dilakukan secara rutin. Nah, ini sekali lagi Bapak Ibu masih bersifat program. Jadi teman-teman program melakukan pelatihan-pelatihan yang sasarannya adalah tenaga-tenaga epid. Nanti kita dalam diskusi mungkin kita bisa lihat di mana sering terjadinya hilangnya tenaga. Lulusan sarjana kesmas juga memiliki kompetensi melakukan kegiatan surveillance di lapangan karena salah satu kompetensi sebagai tenaga kesmas adalah itu. Nah, ini adalah tenaga-tenaga yang kita anggap sebagai tenaga epidemiologi pada saat JEE. Lanjut. Nah, ini hasil-hasil yang sekali lagi sudah kami kumpulkan tahun 2017. Kemudian tugas belajar lingkungan Kementerian Kesehatan juga untuk pendidikan dan penelitian bisa sampai tingkat S3, tetapi untuk pelaksana nggak boleh lebih dari S2. Lanjut. Nah, strategi pengembangan tenaga berdasarkan penilaian kami, penyediaan SDM sudah diimplementasikan dalam dokumen perencanaan. Kami sudah punya rencana pengembangan tenaga tahun 2011-2015, walaupun ini tentunya harus diperbaiki, direvisi, dan rencana aksi program pengembangan pemberdayaan SDM kesehatan 2015-2019. Lanjut. Baik, strategi pengembangan masih di mana perencanaan program direview setiap tahun. Kami punya sistem untuk mendata semua tenaga, Pak. Hanya saja permasalahannya yang mengisi kan harus orang daerah. Sampai hari ini kami menyiapkan anggaran, tapi pada saat anggaran sudah tidak disiapkan, kami khawatir datanya nggak dapat lagi. Mudah-mudahan bisa terus berlanjut, harapannya begitu. Oleh sebab itu sampai dengan sudah hampir 8 tahun kita menyiapkan anggaran untuk entry data SDM sampai tingkat puskesmas. Monitoring evaluasi ya dilaksanakan dengan melibatkan stakeholder tentunya. Lanjut. Ini masih strategi, ada program percepatan pendidikan tenaga kesehatan, ini termasuk tenaga-tenaga caseling dan sebagainya yang nantinya menjadi salah satu calon untuk menjadi tenaga jafung epidemiologi lapangan. Jadi semua tenaga yang levelnya di bawah D3 dilakukan percepatan pendidikan menjadi D3 atau lebih tinggi. Kemudian ada juga kita melakukan pembinaan jafung kesehatan dan non-kesehatan untuk epidemiolog, tentunya untuk kesehatan. Program penugasan khusus dan program pengembangan karir. Ini adalah strategi untuk memenuhi tenaga kesehatan di seluruh Indonesia. Lanjut. Kemudian implementasinya. Dari hasil diskusi, kita melihat pemerintah daerah ini mempunyai kemampuan terbatas untuk mengangkat SDM. Mengangkat dalam artian PNS, Bapak-Ibu. Nah, mungkin ini harus dicari jalan keluar bagaimana supaya pemenuhan tenaga epid yang diharapkan 200 satu orang per 200 penduduk itu terpenuhi. Lanjut. Nah, ini yang terlibat dalam JEE. Lanjut. Bapak dan Ibu, ini indikatornya, saya pikir nanti dibaca saja ya, supaya cepat, karena saya pikir sudah banyak waktu terpakai. Kita lanjut lagi. Ini semua memang saya sajikan karena agak bingung juga waktu mau nyajikan dalam bentuk poin-poin, karena semuanya adalah poin-poin yang dinilai. Ini hasilnya, Bapak Ibu. Ya, hasil kita untuk D41 terjadinya sumber daya manusia SDM untuk implementasi ini nilainya 3. Untuk terdapatnya program pelatihan EPID, kita dapat nilai 4. Sedangkan untuk strategi tenaga kerja, kita dapat nilai 3. Ini yang harus ditindaklanjuti untuk dikembangkan pada tahun ini. Menyusun roadmap-nya, grand strateginya untuk pengembangan tenaga. Lanjut. Bapak Ibu, ini kita lewatkan saja ya, lanjut lagi. Terus ini lampiran-lampiran nanti silakan dibaca, lanjut lagi. Terus ini kegiatan sudah dilakukan, lanjut. Saya ingin memperlihatkan apa yang sudah kami lakukan. Lanjut. Terus ini silakan dibaca saja. Mohon maaf. Terus
Pak Nusli, you have 3 minutes left.
Sudah habis.
3 minutes left.
Oke. Okay. Lanjut lagi. Terus. Satu lagi, ini silahkan dibaca, ini data-data saja, data SDM, terus, lanjut lagi, ini hampir sama. Nah, ini regulasinya, regulasi untuk pengembangan SDM, Bapak-Ibu. Salah satu yang terkuat adalah Undang-Undang nomor 5, sekarang diterjemahkan dalam Undang-Undang PP 11.
Kenapa sekatan terkuat? Ini yang bisa dimanfaatkan oleh teman-teman profesi atau epidemiologi atau epidemiolog untuk menetapkan perlunya tenaga epidemiolog di dinas kesehatan atau puskesmas dalam bentuk syarat jabatan. Jadi kalau itu menjadi syarat, dia akan ada gitu. Selama ini tenaga epid ya boleh ada boleh tidak karena tidak ada syarat yang mengikat. Kemudian kita juga ada juknis, kurikulum modul dan seterusnya. Lanjut lagi. Lanjut. Nah, ini kendala tantangannya umumnya adalah komitmen pelaksanaan yang masih kurang. Lanjut lagi. Terus. Nah, ini tambahan terus satu lagi. Lanjut. Baik. Bapak Ibu, yang apa yang sudah kami lakukan? Yang sudah kami lakukan di pelatihan adalah kita coba memetakan modul-modul di FITP. Karena kita tahu kalau untuk pendidikan sekarang sudah agak sulit terutama dalam pembiayaan, kita coba menjadikan modul ini ke dalam bentuk pelatihan. Dan ini kerjasama dari Badan PSDM dengan UI salah satunya, juga dengan teman-teman dari pertanian, peternakan. Lanjut. Nah, dari modul ini, lanjut lagi. Terus, modulnya ada banyak, ada modul, stop, kelewatan. Atas lagi. Lagi, atas. Ke atas. Atas lagi. Ya, kita coba membuat 18 bentuk pelatihan yang memungkinkan dijadikan pelatihan. Tentu yang kalau teoritis ini kita enggak bisa menang. Tapi untuk yang aplikasi di lapangan, kita coba tarik dia menjadi pelatihan. Lanjut. Lanjut, sudah ya? Oh enggak, ini. Ini kira-kira Ibu, apa yang kami sudah coba petakan, pelatihan-pelatihan yang bisa disusun dan bisa dijadikan pelatihan secara terpisah atau nanti digabung. Kami tetap menggunakan pendekatan berbasis kompetensi, sehingga kompetensi biostatistik jika diperlukan bisa digabung dengan kompetensi ini dan seterusnya. Nah, ini yang sudah kita rancang bersama dengan institusi pendidikan. Lanjut. Nah, ini salah satu contohnya.
Pak Yusri, maaf waktunya habis.
Habis, baik. Sedikit lagi, sini terakhir. Lanjut terakhir. Terakhir. Terus. Ya, ini silakan nanti dipelajari terakhir. Ya. Ini yang dalam proses, Wei. Dari semua yang tadi 18, kita baru memproses 2 modul. Dan ini akan terus berlanjut. Tentunya nanti untuk pembiayaan dan sebagainya kita bisa diskusikan untuk implementasinya. Demikian, terima kasih.
Ya, yeah, thank you very much, Pak Nusri. Terima kasih. Dr. Adel, we will talk on the role of epidemiology at MOH or National Public Health Institute. Now, floor is yours, Dr. Adel.
Letting me here to talk about the role of epidemiologists in the Ministry of Health and National Public Health Institutes. So first, I want to talk about the big picture and all these three groups. Can you go back? Okay. One more. Oh. Forward, please. One more. Okay. All these three groups, this is what we do. It's called public health practice. And this is the definition. The strategic, organized, and interdisciplinary application of knowledge, skills, and competencies necessary to perform essential public health services and other activities to improve the population's health. So the Ministry of Health basically does public health practice. There's some of the ministry that doesn't it, but mostly the ministry does public health practice. And NPHI is within, can you go back? NPHI is an organization usually within the ministry and they're like coordinate public health at a national level. Okay, next. Next. So this is where the epidemiologists come in. Most of us practice public health in the ministry. And some of us will be in a MPHI. And of course, there's some that's not practicing public health, but maybe they're in academia or other places. So the obligations of epidemiologists and the Ministry of Health really come from here, your international health regulations and APSED. So in here they talk about epidemiology, like surveillance, outbreak, and communication, and also about having field epidemiology training. And another one is this global health security agenda. And Indonesia is a big partner of this. They had a big meeting here in Jakarta, 2014. And in 2016, and I know some of you are in this picture. Right there, no, Dr. Kandu. Okay, next. So what do epidemiologists do? Here we operate, manage, and evaluate programs, describe the burden of the diseases, and control and prevent diseases. Next. So here we are, we have the malaria, and you saw this before, the polio. But this is what epidemiologists are involved. We also want to describe the burden of disease. So here are the top 10 diseases in Indonesia. And besides burden, we want to know what's happening, going down, going up, or no change. Okay. And then we want to control diseases, right? So here's our immunization program. Okay. So that's the traditional epi, but I want to move on into focus on interventions instead of describing risk factors, and we want to solve problems. I think as epidemiologists, this is what we need to do, solve problems. And we do that by focusing on interventions. Okay. So this is called now interventional epidemiology. We oversee actions to solve problems. We collect data to evaluate the actions and evaluate actions to prevent future problems. So I've worked with many FETPs in the world, and the two that really focus on this is EPIET, which is in Europe. And the I here stands for interventional. And then your neighbor, Papua New Guinea, they also focus on interventions. They identify a problem, have a solution, and they implement it, and they evaluate it. All in 1 year. It's incredible. And I'm actually on my way now to Papua New Guinea after this, to get them started. Okay. But there's two ways. So the epidemiologists provide support and services and resources and actions for the ministry. But I also think the ministry must support epidemiologists and the use of epidemiology. You know, we all need a job. We have to pay our bills. But then, we want professional development and a career. So, the ministry must recruit, train, and keep epidemiologists. And here's a formula I like to use, 3+1. This is so that you have a strong FETP program. So the 3 comes with the student, a mentor, and a project. So this is about training, and the plus one is here, the career. So I'm sure we have students here. So I want to move on to the mentors. Mentors, usually I think of what I call the three A's: affable, able, and available. Affable means you're likable. In other words, when somebody comes to you, you're friendly and you welcome them. And not say, I don't have time, see me later. Okay. Able, so you must be technically competent. You must know something. And then available, you have time to devote to the students. This is a good mentor. And then for another element, for a strong FETP, a field project that challenges the student and builds skills and confidence. I see too many times students, trainees, doing the same field project as others done years ago. They're just repeating the same thing. It may be another year, another set of data, but it's the same thing. It's not challenging. It's repeating. Please, if you're a mentor, challenge your student. And then finally, the plus one, now that we have someone who is skilled and competent and has confidence, we want to use the graduates to do epidemiology. We spent 2 years training them, a lot of time, a lot of effort. Have them do epi when they're done, because many times they get put into other programs. Next. So what do we want? What does the ministry want from an epidemiologist? We have these competencies. These are more like the hard technical skills. Go ahead, slide, one more. But also, this is just as important, the softer skills that you may not have a module, but you still need to learn leadership, professionalism, program planning, systems thinking. Go beyond just your district, but go beyond. And critical thinking, because we only have 2 years to train you. We can't train you to do everything. So you need this critical thinking to develop and use in your profession. And finally, we need to teach you how to do advocacy and also train and mentoring too, because you are training the future generation, the future epidemiologist. So we talk about curriculum a lot, and we had an introduction from Dr. Newsley about that, about what's proposed. So that's great. But the curriculum basically gives you knowledge plus experience, and that gives you confidence. You must have all three. If you only have two of these and you don't have the confidence, how are you going to explain to people or other people, especially when they disagree with you? Confidence is essential. And then, are we giving students the tools for success?
Sorry, Dr. Alden, you have 3 minutes left.
Okay. And technical skills and knowledge are just not enough. Remember all those soft skills I mentioned earlier? And about epidemiology, what I like to say is we need to teach how to ask the right question. Because asking the right question, we can solve problems. And once again, we're talking about critical thinking, resourcefulness, and taking initiative. So for the MOH and MPHI, we're asking, invest in training competent field epidemiologists and think of making FETP as requirement for all MOH epidemiologists, and this happens in several other countries, Taiwan, all the medical officers for the ministry must complete FETP. And the ministry must train the next generation of competent field epidemiologists and work toward a strong FETP, this formula of 3+1, student, mentor, field project, together, plus a career, really builds a strong program. So we talk about the soft skills, and this is what I call esprit de corps. It's the spirit of a group that makes the members want to succeed. So this is what I hope FETP and PAEI will also encourage, this esprit de corps. And this is another way of looking at esprit de corps, the Avengers. They're working as a group for success. Okay, next. So I'm asking you now, after you go through this conference, what will you do different on Monday? Because I think the conference here is about sharing knowledge and experience, but it's also about you changing. If you're an FETP survivor, become a better mentor. Look at the three A's. Involve FETP in strong projects. PAEI, nourish the concept of esprit de corps and the ministry, the opportunity for FETP to become a problem solver and make mentoring part of the job of staff. So I'll give an example that you can use of the value of FETP, and this is in India. Now they had this encephalopathy happen in one state every lychee season. Every year for the past 10 years, these children would come down with encephalopathy. And in general, they just accepted it as part of life. But the FETP there did a tremendous job. And they found out that this was due to eating lychees. I would highly recommend you to look at this and use this as an example of how FETP and epidemiology can solve problems. And if you don't like to read technical things, you can see a movie called Contagion. It's similar to that. Okay. And thank you for your attention.
Okay. The next speaker will be Dr. Rim Kwang Il. We'll talk on the role of epidemiologists in Guam. Now, floor is yours, Dr. Rim.
Thank you very much, first of all, that inviting WHO for this very important conference. And we are very happy that with all of you, which are senior epidemiologists in this country. Basically, my topic will be about global outbreak alert and response network. This is a global network. This is global partnership based on the existing institute and organization across the country. It's not independent system. It's relying on the country partnership and country partners and organizations. So far, almost over 200 institute and organization involved in this Guam. However, we didn't have Indonesia representation yet. Therefore, my topic today is to highlight why it is important and how this Guam is operating, and then why Indonesia should become the member of this Guam. My presentation will be very introductory part because WHO country office is planning to bring export, real export for Guam to Indonesia to have some training. Then I think many of you will be involved in that workshop, and we will identify which institute are the potential Guam partners. Then we can develop capacities and also we can work together. Next, please. disease outbreak and conflict and emergencies all over the world. Look at it from SARS. From the SARS, we learned that one particular disease outbreak, how fast that disease spread from one country to another. Globally, it created a lot of panic. And also, it implied that how global public health emergency issue becomes a national issue. No longer distinction between global health security and national security. So global issue becomes quickly national issue, and national issue become quickly contribute to global issue. All kinds of things. Look at the MERS, coronavirus. Indonesia, more than 100,000 people going to Saudi Arabia every year for Hajj, and also pilgrim or other Umrah. So there are a lot of implications with international travel and the trade. And also Ebola. Global community learned a lot of important lessons during this Ebola. How much we are ready to really respond quickly disease outbreak. And then this Gohan itself deployed a lot of teams to Ebola outbreak and learned a lot of important lessons. Now Gohan is refocusing its operational modality. And yes, avian influenza, H5N1. Indonesia, and now China is still in line, avian influenza is spreading. We don't know when it will come to Indonesia. And also there are other type of threats and emergencies like radionuclear one and chemical thing. These are the all things that we have to really consider and why we need strong global partnership to respond public health emergencies. Next, please. Next, please. I already mentioned this Ebola. I think from Indonesia, several officials already deployed to Indonesia, to West Africa, Ebola outbreak, and then contribute a lot. Three, Panyoman is very proud of that because epidemic graduate, yes, and already deployed to West Africa to help. This is Gohan approach. We have to really encourage this approach, and we have to build institutional arrangement capacity for that. During the Ebola, it went individual basis. So what we need from Indonesia is to institutional arrangement for this Gohan. This is most important part. Next, please. Then definition of Gohan. Gohan is the global, as I mentioned, Gohan is a global technical partnership established by WHO as a key mechanism to engage resources for rapid identification, confirmation, and response to public health emergencies of international importance. Because this Gohan approach is international approach. International mobilization of human resources for disease outbreak. This is the key message. So far, over 200 technical institutions and network all over the world has involved in Gohan and actively supporting. This is including national government and UN organizations and NGOs as well. Next, please. Gohan has been established in April 2000. And then at the time, only 60 institute has involved. I think CDC Atlanta is the founder of this Gohan, as far as I know. And then Gohan now comprises over 200 partners. It's increased now. And then now approaching to 500 institute all over the world. And then governance system for Gohan is, Gohan has steering committee. 25 members composing steering committee. That committee is governing the Gohan and coordination. And also there is working group. That working group is supporting for based on the specific terms of reference for specific disease outbreak and also project. And WHO is the secretariat for Gohan. WHO is providing secretariat support for this Gohan approach. Next, please. Then what does really Gohan do? Main objective of this network is to provide technical support to WHO member countries experiencing human health emergency due to various threats, which include disease outbreak, food safety, chemical hazard, and genetic disease and disasters as well. Over the 16 years so far, since Gohan established it, Gohan conducted more than 130 operations and deployed over 2,600 experts to assist more than 80 countries all over the world. Next, please. And then how Guan is really deployed. What basically Guan is working, operating based on the request of Ministry of Health. First, government should request for Guan support. Then Guan is deploying the technical export to the countries where there is any emergencies. Then also, in addition to deploying the export in the field, Guan also providing technical advice through export committee established during the emergency situation. And also through Guan, resources are provided for response, including laboratory support and also logistic support and tools and equipment to field team. Beyond providing these kind of direct support to emergency response, Guan also very much engaging for capacity building. Guan is supporting country preparedness, contingency planning, and capacity building. This is also a very important aspect that we can really get support from Guan. And also developing the tools and technology to support field team in the Guan, and also providing network to share information between Guan members, as well as best practices. Countries are producing a lot of best practices. Those best practices will be very useful for other countries to apply in their own country context. Guan is playing that role as well. Next, please. So then there is guideline, then how particular member, particular institute or organization can participate in this Guan networking. There is guideline. Guan is open to all technical institute and organization and network which have interest to deploy their team when there is emergency in other countries. This is the important thing. And also capacity. Capacity is very important. WHO is doing the capacity assessment, whether any particular institute is really has capacity to be deployed for any international outbreak. And all this consideration is made, and then steering committee of the Guan is approved. Who is going to be the partner of Guan? This is the process. And also, once any institute involved in Guan, they should follow guiding principle for international outbreak alert and response. And also there is operational protocol. Once particular institute involved, then they have to follow this operational protocol, which has been agreed before joining to Guan partner. Next, please. So key guiding principle for Guan operation is outbreak of potential intervention on importance should be very definitely verified, and then information from that verification should share very quickly among the Guan members. Of course, it's not openly, fully publicly shared. There is some confidentiality issue still within the Guan member countries. And then rapid response coordinated by the WHO Secretariat to ensure that necessary assistance to particular affected country. Then Guan Secretary to ensure that very fast deploy those teams to countries and coordination support as well. And then international team, when they deploy in the country, they have to integrate, they have to align with country system and country responses. Guan cannot independently operate. They should rely on the country system and country response mechanism. Then also, Guan is playing certain role in terms of technical leadership for response and also coordination effort. Guan is really promoting the every effort to ensure effective coordination of their participation and support of outbreak response. Next, please. In addition to national institute and UN agencies, Guan recognizes unique role of NGOs and international NGOs because they have advantage in reaching out to most vulnerable population and remote area. Therefore, NGO's role in Guan is also very important. And Guan also tried to build global mechanism and capacity to involve by involving FTP, like Epidemiologist Association, like here, and to really enhance the global capacity. This is an important guiding principle which implied with us epidemiologists here. And there is commitment to national and regional capacity building as a follow-up. Because as I mentioned, Guam is also supporting for preparedness and capacity building through delivering the training. And then lastly, when Guam is operate, it's very important to respect particular country law and local law and also human rights issue and cultural sensitivities and traditions. This is very important when any team deployed for a particular country to help them. They have to respect that country's tradition and sensitivities and also laws. Next, please.
Sorry, Dr. Lim, you have 3 minutes left.
Okay. So as I mentioned, since 16 years so far, Guam had a lot of operations and deployment very successfully. Next, please. So I will just skip because Guam, as I mentioned, Guam Secretariat will be operate based on the request from the government side. Then they will facilitate the planning and also information to Guam partners so that the Guam partners can be ready for particular support to any country. Next, please. So when country request any support from Guam, then Secretariat will prepare the CVs of the export, and then that CV will share with the government, then government should approve for their deployment. Next, please. This is the Guam knowledge platform where this request will submit it. Next, please. So when any export deployed with Guam mechanism, it will use WHO short-term consultant mechanism. So in that, WHO will provide financially per diem and travel costs, but there won't be any professional fee. This is very important for institute which plan to deploy their export in other countries, because there won't be any professional fee and just the WHO short-term consultant mechanism. Next, please. As I mentioned, after Ebola outbreak, now Guam is focusing on regional approaches. Previously, Guam just existed at the global level. Now they are focusing on regional approach, which means WHO has 6 regional offices. Therefore, Guam is going to create some coordination mechanism in each regional offices. For Indonesia, there is WHO Southeast Asia regional office in Delhi. That office is coordinating regional Guam networking issues. And it realized that Secretariat support is very important, they need to be strengthened. And in addition to Guam networking, there are other partners as well for global health, global emergencies, like a global health cluster, emergency medical team, and WHO standard by partners. Guam should closely work with those other partners as well. Like, for example, emergency medical team. In Indonesia, for disaster situation, emergency medical team role was very important, and also emergency medical team in Indonesia is actively participating with global EMT project. Next, please. So core areas of Guam is, of course, governance and oversight, and alert and risk assessment, and response training, and coordinate rapid response capacities. And finally, Guam also working for conduct research and also developing tools. Next, please. Guam, as I mentioned, there is Guam training. There are 3 types of training. One is very basic. This is based on online. I'll be very quick. Yeah, yeah. And then second one is scenario-based training. Actually, we had already WHO country office already planned this scenario-based training in Indonesia context. We may use some scenario to really give training for potential Guam partners in Indonesia. And then third one is some training related with leadership. Next, please. Yes, Guam emergence available in Guam network. Next, please. Yes, this is scenario-based training which we can plan in Indonesia. Next, please. I'll give some example of Guam. Who are the Guam partners? Number one, Africa Center for Disease Control and Prevention, Ethiopia. Number two, Ministry of Health branch itself become Gohan partner, and then some universities as well, and armed forces can be Gohan partner, and FTP Malaysia is also Gohan partner, and the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine also is Gohan partner, CDC Atlanta, China CDC, and some institutes as well can be Gohan partner. These are the examples, so you can have a look this, which institute can be a potential partner for Gohan. Next, please. Okay, then what next with Indonesia? Number one, we have to identify who can be a potential Gohan partner in the country. Number two, before going to that part, that aspect, we have to really think about how Indonesia can really develop, establish network within the country, national and sub-national level, because Indonesia has decentralized. Therefore, I think similar mechanism with Gohan can be applied in Indonesia context. That's what Pak Nyoman always trying to advocate, that we have to establish this before going to global network. We have to think about national network first to ensure this mechanism working in the country context, then that can be applied in global level. And capacity strengthening, yes, including Gohan training, we will do. We closely coordinate with the Ministry of Health and also FTP and also Indonesia Epidemiology Association to do training in relation with Gohan. And then lastly, register and participate in Gohan activities, not only in national level, but also regional and global level, so that Indonesia can contribute global outbreak response and activities. So that's where Indonesian leadership for health matters comes in. Yeah. Next, please. I think as I mentioned, when we plan training, Dr. Anthony, he's a person who is in charge of Gohan in our WHHQ. I think he promised to come over to Indonesia to conduct training. So there is already commitment. So we will work on that. And then there are Gohan website. You can visit that website to have a look without information, additional information available. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. Kebetulan Pak Nusri Irmansyah akan meninggalkan tempat ini sekarang karena pesawatnya jam 2 siang ini harus berangkat. Jadi kalau saya akan buka satu sesi pertanyaan saja untuk PPSM. Satu ya, Bapak saja, secepat Bapak. Nanti akan dijawab oleh Pak Nusri. Silakan Pak.
Pertanyaan saya mungkin saya tujukan kepada Dr. Kuang. Yang terkait dengan global alert.
Sorry Pak, ini untuk Dr. Nusri dulu satu pertanyaan. Nanti Bapak akan dapat yang pertama, oke. Gak jadi masalah. Yang untuk Dr. Nusri dulu, karena Dr. Nusri yang akan meninggalkan tempat saja. Yang Dr. Alden dan Dr. Kim Rim akan tetap di sini. Oke, Bu Sisil. Agak cepat Bu Sisil, karena Pak Nusri ngejar pesawat.
Terima kasih Dr. Niko dan Pak Nusri pertanyaannya Pak. Tadi memang panjang lebar, salah satu kendala di untuk perhimpunan ahli epidemiolog, untuk epidemiolog kesehatan itu untuk suatu profesi itu harus ada D3 dan D4 Pak. Nah menurut saya PPSDM punya poltekkes di seluruh Indonesia, usul saja Pak, bagaimana peluang ke depan kalau dibuka epidemiologi untuk yang fokusnya, terapannya, supaya kompetensi yang tadi kata, karena Bapak pelaksanaan tidak boleh S3 tadi ya, salah satu untuk melengkapi untuk Indonesia mungkin puskesmas dan sebagainya, di mana mungkin ada plus yang ilmunya pile itu very good banget gitu. Terima kasih. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Okay. Silakan Pak Nusri.
Saya ingin menjelaskan sedikit saja bahwa di dalam struktur ketenagaan di Indonesia itu ada profesi dan ada jabatan fungsional. Profesi itu sifatnya umum, mau di PNS maupun swasta dia punya profesi tertentu. Tetapi jabatan fungsional ini khusus di PNS yang melakukan pekerjaan sesuai dengan fungsinya, tetapi untuk pengangkatannya tidak harus linier. Oleh sebab itu tadi yang ditanyakan oleh Pak Bu Sisil, apakah harus ada D3 epidemiologi? Kalau ini dibutuhkan oleh profesi secara umum, ya, tetapi yang perlu dipikirkan adalah kebutuhan di lapangannya Bapak Ibu. Tetapi untuk di jabatan fungsional, untuk pejabat fungsional yang level D3 sampai S1 itu dimungkinkan dari tenaga profesi lain yang dilatih. Jadi seperti dari caseling bisa, dari perawat bahkan bisa gitu ya, untuk menjadi pejabat epidemiolog. Artinya kalau untuk di pemerintahan ini dibuka lewat pelatihan. Sedangkan kalau dianggap memang dibutuhkan di profesi, ini bisa diusulkan Bu, tapi tentunya harus dihitung betul kebutuhannya sehingga pada saat kita buat pendidikannya diserap. Mungkin demikian Bu Sisil. Terima kasih. Bapak dan Ibu sekalian, saya mohon maaf karena setting saya tadi jam 10 sampai jam 12, jadi saya set jam 2 saya pulang karena ternyata mundur. Saya mohon maaf tidak bisa mengikuti sampai akhir. Sekali lagi saya tanpa mengurangi arti dari pertemuan ini ya, saya sangat tertarik sebetulnya, tapi karena ada tugas lain saya izin. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Ya, tepuk tangan buat Pak Nusli. Terima kasih Pak Nusli, thank you very much Pak Nusli for your presentation and the answer. Ladies and gentlemen, no worry, I'm still open for question and answer for 10 minutes because we still have 10 minutes. Tadi Bapak ya, tadi saya akan jadi pertanyaan pertama, belakangnya kedua, and the last question will be Pak Riyadi. So we have three.
Saya kenalkan lagi, saya Gun Cahya dari Kantor Kesehatan Pelabuhan Palembang. Yeah. Saya ingin menanyakan kepada Dr. Kuang, kita dalam waktu dekat ini kita akan menghadapi melaksanakan Asian Games, Pak. Jadi Asian Games mulai Agustus tidak kurang dari 45 negara masuk ke Indonesia, dan beberapa negara memang masih kategori endemik. Dan tidak kurang dari 3.000 masuk ke Palembang di Sumatera Selatan. Oleh karena itu kami mohon arahan, mohon penjelasan dari Kuang, apa yang sudah akan dilakukan oleh WHO khususnya di Wuhan ini dalam proteksi masuknya kemungkinan masuknya penyakit dari luar negeri, dan apa yang kita sebaiknya kita lakukan gitu ya, untuk mencegah terjadinya outbreak yang dari luar negeri. Saya kira itu Pak, terima kasih.
Terima kasih Pak. Tadi Pak Anton ya Pak ya.
Pak Kun Cahyo, Pak.
Oh, Kun Cahyo, oke. Okay. Silakan selanjutnya. Ya. Terima kasih Pak Kun Cahyo.
I will direct my question to Mr. Kuang. Oke, okay, my name is Jusli. I am from PAEI of NTT Province. Oke, okay, my question is, can you give example what Guan has do with Ministry of Health of Indonesia? Maybe one example, your collaboration as long as so far, I mean. And then my second question is if we do a research in our local area, can we propose fund to Gohan? Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Yusli. Selanjutnya Pak Haryadi, silakan.
I have one comment for Pak Arim and one comment for Pak Alden. I start with Pak Arim. If we are talking about the Guan as a network, to my understanding, network must consist of hub and line. The hub is the related parties in that network, means government and private, including us as a professional organization. The line, which is very important, are the mechanism how network will work properly, including how communicate, and including the advisory mechanism and also risk communication, because we learn from the experience that one of the important things that missing or lacking is the risk communication. This is for Pak Arim. For Pak Alden, I'm interested with your one short sentence, with this, the use and career development for the epidemiologists. The use of epidemiologists, it means among the consumer, maybe the government or maybe the private. But talking about the career development fully under the government policy, the problems now, we as the professional organization, we start to develop the career pathway and the competency standard. But at the end, the government has to decide under the Minister of Health what kind of care development to assure that epidemiologists will stay and happy in their position. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Pak Haryadi. Indonesia will, for the first questions, Indonesia will hold the Asian Games in September this year. This Asian Games will involve 45 countries and also 3,000 athletes. So the question is, what should be done for preparing of these Asian Games in terms in regard to the governance activities? I think for the second and the last question from Pak Haryadi, okay, you can answer directly. So the first, maybe Dr. Lin first, okay.
You raise very important issue now because Asian Games is approaching. And then I think Indonesia is absolutely ready in terms of addressing the trauma injuries and also mobilizing ambulances and also identifying referral health services for those. But thing is, what I observe, still you need something for public health, like a disease outbreak and all that, how to prevent and also protect. So this is very important. So therefore, WHO has collaborated with Ministry of Health, and in February this year, we have organized training for mass gathering from the international health regulatory perspective for this Asian game. I think his province health office from Palembang came to that training, as far as I remember. And we discussed a lot, what is the risk at the moment in the context of this Asian game? So potential risk, we identified several risks. So like, for example, food safety issue, water and sanitation, vector-borne diseases, and the disease outbreak. We identified several risks. Based on that risk assessment, Ministry of Health is going to develop a preparedness plan, some contingency plan. And then that also setting up surveillance system, because this Asian Games surveillance will be different from ordinary normal government surveillance system for diseases. It will be focused daily based reporting system, and if anything happened, then how fast team is mobilized to investigate and also response. These are the very key public health practices and the interventions required in the context of mass gathering, because we are talking about mass gathering. Massive number of people are coming, athletics and non-athletic. They are mingling with the ordinary people. So there is certainly very high risk. Therefore, Ministry of Health, in collaboration with WHO, already identified key priority risk. And based on that risk, there is now developing contingent preparedness plan. Then that plan can be tested through some tabletop exercise and simulation exercise. That's the plan right now. So I think, I hope that plan will be implemented over the coming months, and from May to July, before August. This is the kind of thing I can at least brief you from WHO perspective. Number two question about how WHO so far did collaboration with Ministry of Health in Government of Indonesia for Goan. Yes, we did already several things with the government, that in 2012, there was Goan training in Indonesia. I think as far as I remember, it is in Medan. And then WHO convened this Goan training and brought several institute export to that training. But unfortunately, the people trained in Goan at that time, I heard that not many people still in that particular institute. Therefore, it is for us to really reactivate and also do training again, because now in 2018, that training has happened in 2012. So now gap. So that's why WHO plan to do training again, based on the new development of Guam approach and operational modalities. That will happen sometime this year. Because you may remember this morning when Pak Anung made his speech, opening speech, he mentioned that Guam is very important for Indonesia. Therefore, Ministry of Health will collaborate with WHO to do some training, as well as to identify the mechanism, how Guam, Indonesia Institute become member of Guam partnership. So that we will keep doing, and also will involve relevant institute and organization in Indonesia to really encourage Indonesia to become the full member of Guam. That's the thing. Yes, in terms of research, as I mentioned, that Guam also supporting research project, operational resources, and also some development resources. So I think you can closely work with the Ministry of Health, especially surveillance department, to propose what are the key research questions, whether that question is really helpful for improving the networking of epidemiologists in Indonesia context, as well as to deploying to other countries, then that project or research can be really discussed with the Ministry of Health. Once Ministry of Health submit the proposal to us, then we can certainly work together on that part. Next one is in terms of mechanism. Yes, Bahariadi, you're absolutely right. We have hardware already, hub, but how to link those hubs? That's a really very important question. Because of time limitation, I could not explain how this mechanism can be established in terms of coordination and communication and advisory group, whatever. As I mentioned, in Guam, there are three in Guam headquarter level. Number one is steering committee. That is for governance and coordination. And there is subcommittee. Sub-steering committee. That subcommittee will be working on each specific area. Like when you say Guam, it includes epidemiologists, clinicians, and laboratory people. There are several cross and also infection prevention and control. There are several technical areas. For those technical areas, there is subcommittee. In addition to that, there is working group. As I mentioned, working group will work based on specific terms of reference and also based on need in particular point of time. That's the thing. And communication between country partner and Guam, how that communication happen. Country should nominate, when they become the member of Guam, they should nominate who is going to focal point from that particular partner organization. For example, Indonesia Epidemiology Association become the member of Guam, then you should identify who is the focal point in your institute to liaise with that Guam. Or you can delegate some authority to some Guam focal point already in member of that Guam steering committee that, okay, you help us to communicate and coordinate our effort, partners' effort to with Guam. There is mechanism. So once it's clear that any particular institute become member, then those communication protocol and mechanism can be explained and distributed. I think okay. So far.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Lim, and now it's Dr. Ander.
It's both government, private, and public. So what we know is about 85% of the graduates remain with the Ministry of Health, and about the other 15 are dispersed. They may go back to private practice, academia, or some kind of private company. And as far as developing a career path, yes. I mean, it's the government who really makes the decision. I mean, we can advocate, but the government really sets the guidelines of the career path for our graduates.
Thank you, Dr. Aden, for your answer. Ladies and gentlemen, I know this session is very interesting, but because we have limited times, let me summarize of this sessions. This session we have three speakers, Pak Nusli talking on the rules and strategy of epidemiology in workforce development of human resource setting in Indonesia. Dr. Aden talk on the role of epidemiologists in In general, talking about in public health practices, also there is a chance the role of epidemiologists in international health regulation, global health security agenda, and other public health interventions, activities, or projects. Dr. Rims, talking on GWANs, the role of epidemiologists in GWANs, and also the challenge for the epidemiologists to participate or join to the GWAN. Then I think this is talking about the role and the rules of epidemiologists in Indonesia to participate in all public health practices and epidemiologist activities. Now I think this is the end of the sessions. Please give big applause to all the speakers. And now I turn it back to the pembawa acara. Thank you very much for your attention.
The honorable distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, we would like to invite again to Dr. Alden Henderson and Dr. Rim Kwang Il as our great appreciation and thanks for his great support and guidance. Mike kindly to come forward to the stage. We invite Dr. E. Nyoman Kandun to kindly give the souvenir.